Hello again, harness fans. Whatever's left of you. It's Sunday afternoon, March the 22nd. Figure I'll do a little DNRS recap show and talk about a few things today on Sunday afternoon after church. As we sit around and wait for another outstanding Balmoral Sunday night card that Doc Narotsky has put together for us with the short fields and a bunch of rat races. But you know what? I guess we got to take what they give us nowadays. And then it's probably only going to get worse, I guess. Hoosier Park opens up next weekend. So Sammy the Widge Pidge Winger, he'll be going to Hoosier. And Wolfong will be gone. And all of the Wolfong horses. And God knows who else is going to be there. I'm sure Willis, Spider Willis, will be sending some down there to race. And Fox Valley Libero will be on his way down there for a PJ. You know, that guy that owns the Libero horse. And who else? I don't know. Is Ellison allowed to race in Indiana? If he is, I'm sure he'll take Cam Weiser down there and some of those things. So God knows what we're going to have left here, or not here, but back in Chicago. Who knows what we're going to have left to bet on when Hoosier opens. I guess we've got to get ready for some short fields and some entries and just a bunch of non-winners of one that pace in about 2.5 and trotters that pace in about 2.10 or whatever they throw at us. We'll have to, same old horses at Maywood, of course. And we'll have to just, put up with what they give us. But as long as we have winners and as long as we cash tickets, I guess the money, that's all that counts for some of us. You know, races are races, I guess. And we'll have to bet on what they put on the track for us to bet on. Just get some winners and gimmicks and make some money and we're happy. Because money pays the bills, right? Money pays the bills. Yep. Got to make money in this world, otherwise you can't live. Either that or you got to get it handed to you. Got to inherit it. Got to be born with a golden spoon in your mouth. Something. But anyway, yep. So it's Sunday. As I said before already, nice day in Vegas here. I looked at the weather in Chicago. It said 37 degrees in Melrose Park. And, it's only about 80 here. That's all. Sunny, 80, late, upper 70s. It was like 82 yesterday. Gorgeous. Gorgeous yesterday. It's sunny now today out there. I'm looking out at the mountains and all the green trees and the green bushes. Yeah, everything's looking pretty like it always is. But what are you going to do? That's Vegas. People live all over the world. Everybody can't live in the same spot. I'm in a rut. I'm all shook up. Ho, ho, ho. So anyway, let's get to some DNRS recaps for Thursday, Friday, and Saturday and see what we can talk about. Oh, let me, don't forget, tonight at Cal Expo, they got a carryover in the high five, $11,000. Nobody hit it last night, so they're going to carry that over. So the pool should be pretty good in that high five at Cal Expo in the last race tonight. So you guys might want to go on there and try to take that down, you know. Maybe take a quick pick. Yeah, take a quick pick. Maybe you'll hit it. Yeah. You know, not handicap. Take a quick pick like the guy did when he won $200,000. Yeah. All you need in the world is luck. You don't need to be good. You just need luck in the world. That's all. Get lucky. Get lucky in life. All right. Well, before I get into the recap, let me have a little swig of grape juice. Thank you. Sorry about that. All right. Let's go to Thursday at Maywood Park. I had 4 top-rated winners. 3 second-rated winners, 1 third-rated, and 1 fourth-rated winner out of the 10 races. 7 winners came out of my top 2. 4 were top-rated. So, in the first race, we started out with a nice exacting gimmick with the second-rated winner on top. I had him rated 614523, came in 143. No super in the first race, short field of 6 horses. 4 claimers. They can't even fill 4 claimers in Chicago. Can't even fill 4s. Anyway, came in 143. The exacta paid $30, and the tri paid a nice $281. Second-rated winner on top. Third-rated ran second. And the 3, who I had rated in my numbers down lower, ran third. So, started out with a nice winner there. And then, race number 2, the top-rated winner won. Top-rated winner on top, 5 deep, or 4 deep, whatever you want to do. Run the top rated first and second, any way you want to do it. And the executive paid 20, but the tribe paid 123. 172 it came back. Had them rated 12687. So that was good for a $20 exacta and a $123 tri. Put the top rated horse on top. And that was the second leg of the jackpot pick six that nobody's hit yet. One single winner. We're still waiting to see how that is. So we started out the pick six with a second rated winner and a top rated winner. Then we moved on to the third leg of the pick six and we had another top rated winner. The payoffs weren't that big this race. Bust My Chops win it, top rated. Exacta paid $21.40, not bad. Tri only paid $70. I had him rated 325.417, came in 3521. And the super paid 119 with the top rated winner on top. Alright, moving on to race number four. Second rated winner. Nice exacta. Second rated won. Third rated ran second. Top rated ran third. So right there, my top three horses. And exacta paid a nice $56. Box up the top three if you like. For $12, get back $56. Key to second rated on top, get back $56. However you guys bet, I don't know. And box my top three rated horses, get a $91.60 try. I didn't have the super that race though. Six horse, Steffi Clay got third. I've got fourth, and I didn't have him in my numbers. But nevertheless, top three rated horses with a second rated winner, $56 exacta, $91 try. And I don't believe there was any nonsense in that race. So moving on to race number five, another top rated winner. And the gimmicks paid good here too. I had him rated 321657, came in 356. $69 exacta with the top rated horse on top. And a $297 try. With the top rated horse on top, five deep. Jostling Jack. I think he paid $14, by the way. Yep, top rated $14 winner. I don't know how he got off at $14. It looked like a cinch to me. But anyway, so that was the fifth leg of the pick six. So let me see how we fared here. In the first leg of the pick six, of course, we had a second rated winner. In the second leg, we had a top rated winner. In the third leg, we had a top rated winner. And then in the fourth leg, we had a second rated winner. And then in the fifth leg, we had a top rated winner. Looks good in that pick six so far, huh? With a $14 horse and what was the other prices? I can't remember. Didn't write the win prices down. But I think one paid 10 and a couple chalks in there. So let's move on and see how we did in the last leg of the pick six. Oh, we had the top rated winner. That's right. The gimmicks didn't come back too big. Top rated winner on top. Second rated ran second. So it was an ice cold exacta for 10 skins. $10 only. That's it. And then the one horse ran third, who I had rated down there underneath my top two rated horses. Then the try came back $63. So, that took care of the pick six. What was that? Four top rated and two second rated? Something like that? Okay. And the pick six came back $101. Easy as pie. $101. And no nonsense in there. W.H. Carmen. She's getting good now, huh? Boy, nice drive by Osteen there, huh? He left right out of there with Seat the Glamour and got in the two-hole and then snapped the Glamour right at the wire. Snapped her down. Yeah. Heads-up drive by little Mike Osteen. Okay. So that's how the first six races went, huh? Heh. All kind of winners, all kind of gimmicks. What do you say, guys? All right, let's move on to race number seven, which is the start of the pick four. And what do we have here? Oh, we had a third-rated winner win that race. Second-rated ran second. And top-rated ran third. So there you go again, gentlemen. DNRS top three-rated horses. Raw hit the board. 1, 2, 3 with a third-rated winner. $61 exacta. Box up my top three-rated. $61 for 12. Box up my top three-rated for the try. $12 bet for $2. Get back $224 on the try. Right there in front of you. 367. Came back 763. And the one. Oh, there was no super in that race. He was fourth. If there was a super, the fourth rated horse ran fourth. But there was no super in that race. So nice payouts right there. Huh, gentlemen? Huh, gentlemen? Huh, gentlemen? With the top three rated horses. How'd you guys do this week? Huh? Anyway, that's the way that race went. Simple as pie. Moving on to race number 8. Oh, yeah, we got Ramrod in here. Yeah, we got the old Ramrod job in the race number. We had to get one Ramrod job going on. Not me. I didn't Ramrod him. They Ramrodded all the gamblers this race. Okay, let's talk about this race. Didn't cash nothing there. And, you know who won the race? The four horse. My man Roland, I Roland Smolin. Yep, old Bobby. He rolls everything now, boy. He's a gasser. He's a Mark Aubin now. Yeah, isn't he? Yeah. Old Bobby loves rolling those babies. I'm not going to duck. I'm going out. I'm racing these horses. I don't stiff. Not like some of these guys. So Bobby rolls this thing. Let's see. Casey Leonard drove the thing the last four starts. Last start. Now, this is against the same horses. Same class, same horses, same pigs. Okay, that he raced against last week. They put the Ustein on Dakota Snow. For some reason, Anderson didn't show up the 2 days in a row. But they put Ustein on this horse, who looked like a cinch. Okay, but he left Woodham and had it settle for the three-hole. Because Bobby gassed his four right out. Doesn't show 1 ounce of speed on this program. But Bobby gassed him. He found speed Thursday night for Merv Chupp. Yeah. Last start with Leonard on him in this class. 7th. By 13, paced in 2-2. Start before that, 6 by 14, Leonard, paced in 2-2. Start before that, off the rail. No speed on the rail now. No speed on the rail, from the rail. But Leonard up. Got away 5th, off the rail. 7th by 7 in 2-5 and 3. Yeah, those are his last four starts before the qualifier. Okay, but he did show a win. He showed a win here. Four starts back, he showed a win. On his hands and knees, he won by a head. On his hands and knees in 2-2 and 2. From behind. Yeah. On his hands and knees by a head. But then after that win in the same class against these same horses, 7th by 13, 6th by 14, 7th by 7 with Leonard. What happened? All of a sudden, they put Bobby up, and Bobby can roll him. Went right to the lead, wire to wire. Lit up the board. And the thing about it, no, he didn't light up the board. I take that bet. A horse with these lines, he only goes off at 9-1. 9-1 only. 10-1 last start with Leonard. 43-1 to start before. And 4-1 off the rail and 7th by 7. But he found speed for Bobby at only 9-1. So he got the job done. He got the job done. Bobby rolled him. We'll see what happens to this horse next week. But that's what you got to do. What are you going to do? You can't do nothing about it. Turn the page over and go to race number 9 and get yourself a second-rated winner. Second-rated winner on top, 5 deep. $51 exacta. I had him rated 452167. Came in 5126. $51 exacta, $111 try, and a $241 exact super. Second-rated horse on top, 5 deep. That simple. Steph's place. Warren, dropping down. Dropping down in the fours. But they're all fours, remember? Now winners of 8,500, last 5. He dropped into fours and wired them up. That's it. And then race number 10, fourth-rated winner in that race. Golden Nugget from the outside. Yeah, he rated 4th from the 8-hole. What are you going to do? But he got the lead easy. He got the lead easy and wired him up. So there was no problem there. Came in 8-5-2-7. I had him rated 9-2-7-8-5. So 8-5-2-7. I can't even remember who was 5th in here. But it doesn't matter. Because Golden Nugget won, and he was 4th rated. So that's it for Thursday. That's it for Thursday. And we'll move on to Friday. All right. Friday, I had only 2 top-rated winners, but I had 5 second-rated winners. So those second-rated horses were strong on Friday. And 3 third-rated winners and 1 fourth-rated winner. So 7 winners out of the 12 races came out of my top 2 rated. 10 winners out of the 12 races came from my top 3 rated horses. That's all you had to do. You don't have to go up no further. And if you want to take it a step further, One fourth rated winner. But out of the 12 races, 10 winners came from my top three. You don't have to look no further than send down the DNRS top three and find that winner. And the gimmicks to go along with it, probably. Most likely. We'll see how it goes. Top rated winner in the first race. Short trifecta, a short exacta, short try, short super. Nothing to write home about. Beast Sand. Had him rated 251,476. Came in 2,415. $12 exacta, $30 try, $41 super. Popcorn. Race number two. Second rated winner. Decent gimmicks here. Second rated winner on top. Five deep. Get you all the gimmicks. All of them. Second rated winner on top. Five deep. Top two rated on top. Five deep. Okay? Do the math. Want me to do the math for you? It's like a $42 bet and you collect all of this. You collect a $2 try. $2 exacta. A 50 cent try. And a 10 cent super. For $42. Had him rated 867,431. Came in 6,483. $49 exacta, $222 try. So that's $55 for 50 cents. And a $439 super, that's $43.90 for a 10 cent super. Bohemia with Carpenter win the race. Yep, easy as pie. Race number three. Okay, third rated winner in there. Top three rated horses ran 1, 2, 3. No super in that race. Short field is 6. Laverne won it. Laverne's horse. I had him rated 3rd first start off the qualifier. But he win it in fashion. He win it in fashion. And for Vern. Oh, Vern can still drive, can he? Oh, Vern is 60 years old or 61, whatever he is. He's close to my age. I know that. Oh, Vern can still drive him. He's not retiring to become a steward. He's going to drive. He's going to be a lifer. Okay. So anyway, third rated won, top rated was second, second rated was third. $19 exacta, $49 try, box up my top three for $12, get back $41.49. All right, that's how that went, short field. And that was the start of the jackpot pick six. And then in the fourth race, I had him rated 427,365, came in 2,457. So once again, second rated horse on top, five deep, but the gimmicks were horrible this race. Horrible. Did I write this down right? The exacta only paid $380? No, $1,360. I'm sorry. I knew it couldn't pay that cheap. $1,360. A try paid $55 and the super paid $101. So, short payouts on the gimmicks. Can't make much money in that race with the winner staring you right in the face. Unless you pound on them for big money. Because you selected to do it the right way. Anyway, third rated and second rated starts out the pick six. Then in race number five, fourth rated winner in there. I had him rated 743,162, came in 1,467. I didn't even write the payoffs down in this race. They were chalky. Oh, yeah, that's right. They had the entry in there. Yeah, I remember that race now. The entry of Doomside Art and At Max Speed. Well, let me see here. Nash Speed had the three-hole. Date Hall had the rail with Bobby Altepeter. And Southwind Scorpion had the two-hole. Now, we all know Nash Graham's always had that good speed when he wants to use it. Good speed, 27 first quarters if he wants to use it. Now, you got Max Speed and Doomside Art on the outside of him. But those two gas out to the lead. They gas out that entry. And of course, Nash Graham leaves too. But Nash Graham's got to settle for the three-hole for some reason. He can't even get away second. With his speed. The entry gets away 1-2. So they sit that way around the whole track. And they pound this entry down to 6-5. It's At Max Speed. 0-5 this year. He's been a rat. He's been a total rat, this horse. And Doomside Art, he's a stopper. He's got all that speed, but he stops late in the mile. But Casey had to get away third with Nash Graham. Then they sat that way around the whole track, and then Casey finally had a pull going through the three quarters and make his move, which he did. And he came right up alongside Doomside Art. And he go right by around the last turn. He cleared him by about 3/4 of a length, but he didn't clear him all the way. But he hit that turn, and he was like 3/4 of a length in front. Now here's Ulstein sitting in the pocket. He decides he's going to go to the outside behind Nash Graham. But then again, he decides he's going to change course again and go back down to the wood. They hit the stretch, and Casey's going to go right by the Doonside Art. But here comes Ulstein up the rail after he alters course. And he wins. They got the 6-5 shot home, and he won. Casey Leonard. I guess he was surprised to see Ulstein go up the inside. Maybe if he drove the horse a little harder, he might have cleared Doonside Art and opened up enough not to get snapped. But he did. So that's it. Race number 6. Third rated winner. Had him rated 2-1-5-6. Came in I had him rated 5-6-2-1. It came in 2-1-6-5. Top four horses right there again. Try Super and Exacta. Exacta paid 21.80. Third rated winner on top. Fourth rated ran second. Second rated ran third. Top rated ran fourth. You'd have to box them up there. $74 try and $111 super. $111 minus 24. Box up top four for $24. Dollar super. Not 10 cents. $24. Get back $111. That's a nice profit. Even, yeah, right? Moving on to race number 7. Top rated winner. Lestrade Hanover came right back and won. Paid $14, top rated winner. Had him rated 7-5-3-1-2-4. Came in 7-1-4-5. So top rated winner on top, 5 deep. $44 exacta, $730 trifecta. No, that can't be right. No, I got to check this out. I got to check these payoffs out and see what this payoff was. Let me pull up Maywood Park Reel here on this lightning fast computer here. That was Thursday night Maywood results. Let's go to the charts here and let's scroll down to race number 7. Oh, I'm sorry. Friday night, not Thursday. Let's scroll down to race number 7 Friday night. Okay, Lestrade. Yeah, it did. It did. Paid $730. Yep, I had it down right. Wow. Top rated winner on top, 5 deep. $44 exacta, $730 try, and an $830 super for $1. Yep. Man, how did that pay that much? Truly Wild was 10-1 more. Oh, yeah, that's right. They scratched the 8, Speed Minister. When the 8 was scratched, the 4 horse moved into the 8 slot. And the 4 wound up getting third. And he made it pay, because I guess he was a big long shot. Because the 5 horse ran 4, Taruk, and he was 7-2 morning line. So, nice payoffs. Lestrade Hanover on top, top rated winner. There you go, gentlemen. Now, moving on to the 8th race. Second rated winner. Chalk payouts here. I had him rated 1-6-7-5-2-4. Came in 1-6-2-5. $9 exacta only. Top 2 rated horses. $40 try. And a $50 super. No money there. But anyway, top second rated winner. Top rated ran second there. Now, in the pick 6. Let's see what we had here in the pick 6 for DNR selections. We'll start with the first leg. Third rated, second rated, fourth rated, third rated, top rated, second rated. There it is. There's your pick 6. All right there staring you in the face. You know who knocked me out? You know who knocked me out of my pick six tickets? Yeah. The entry, Doonside Art, and Max Speed. If Nash Graham wins the race, I got the pick six. But of course, they bet this one down the chalk, and they somehow worked together with that entry, and they got the job done. Knocked me out of the pick six. I had it on Thursday night. I had it Thursday. Had two tickets on, I think. Maybe one. I don't remember. But I know I had it Thursday. Friday, I didn't have it. Because that entry knocked me out of it. I played a bunch of tickets, but in the combinations I used, I just didn't have that one horse. I had him in other tickets, but I just didn't have him in the ticket that was live. One or two tickets that were live, I just didn't have them. I had Nash Graham. So anyway, where are we at here now? Okay, race number nine. Race number nine. That was the start for the pick four. Second rated winner. Second rated winner, third rated ran second, top rated ran third. There it is again, top three rated horses right there with a second rated winner. Gimmicks were short, $16 on the exact and only $52 on the try, second rated winner. Desperado Alibi. Ready ran third. Ready just wasn't ready this week to take the class jump and beat these horses. Well, that's how race number nine was. Now moving on to race number 10. Oh, yeah, race number 10. Didn't have nothing here. Can you believe it? I must be a bad handicapper. Didn't have nothing this race. Some say to me, Dan, how could you not have Silver Devil off the rail? I don't know. I guess if I go back to last year, let's see. If I go back to September, I can have Silver Devil like I did last week when he went off at last start on February 20th when he went off 160 to a dollar. I had him. Yeah, I had him rated in. Because we all know the class he's got. He was in and out when it was a 4,000 last time out. Went off at 160 to a dollar. Same class this week. Now when it's a 4,000. Yeah, if I go back to September again. But that's September months ago. Well, you know, he qualified on February 11th in Balmoral. Nothing to write home about, by the way, for this kind of horse. He qualified third, got beat a couple lengths in 55-3. But, you know, nevertheless, last start, first start off the qualifier, decent qualifier, not bad. And all those great lines in September, pasting 150-3 against Best Man in Hanover. He beat Gibbs. But you know what? Last week he came out and he just wasn't ready. He was no good. 160 to a dollar, had the two-hole. He even pulled the horse and gave him a shot. Not like he didn't try. He pulled the horse. And the horse came up, it was empty, totally empty. Got beat by So Be It. A 6,000, and Cotton Eye Joe. $6,000 claimers he got beat by last time. First start. Against those pigs who he should have destroyed. That's why, you know, 160 to a dollar, everybody knows he's supposed to destroy that field. He had the tightener with the qualifier. Now, if he was in against somebody, then you could say, well, he needed to start. But not against those pigs. Empty. But not Friday night. Hadn't raced in 3 weeks off of that horrible first start. But man, was he ready on Friday. Huh? 153. 153! Just jogged on him. Got away in the two-hole behind Fox Valley Norman and sat there and just blew him away in the stretch. In 53. Not 55 or 54, but 53. What happened last start, Giberson? Why was the horse so bad last week? That's why he didn't rate for me. Okay? When they race like that, they don't rate. But he sure was good. But he stunk the start before. with no pace whatsoever, but he found that pace. He won at 53 Friday. Yeah. Race number 11, second-rated winner, chalk payouts. Top-rated ran second. Third-rated ran third. Had him rated 1-5-2-4-6-8, came in 5-1-2. Didn't have the 7 for fourth. Top two rated horses, $8 exacta. Top three rated horses, $56 try. The only thing you can make money on is the try. If you box the top three for 12 bucks, you get back 44. You profit 44. You get back 56, you profit 44. So, that's that. And then race number 12. All right. Oh, yeah. The race with the photo. Race number 12. Mm-hmm. Okay. I had them rated 3-8-1-9-7-6. Thought the 3 and 8 stunk. They stunk. So my third rated horse won. My fourth rated ran third, and my fifth rated was second. Okay, those top two rated horses I had rated 1-2, they stunk. They were going up in class in that. I probably shouldn't have had them rated that high, but I did. But anyway, when I saw how they're betting the one horse off the rail, and we all know the one horse is a nice mare, give me a smooch, I figured, yeah, you know what, she's the best in there. So let me start making some tickets here with the one on top. You know, and run the one on top and maybe second and stuff like that, because obviously, you know, with the rail and the speed, she's going to be good, which she was. I thought she would whack it. I thought she'd put Cold Blue in the hole, but Cold Blue's got that speed, but so does give me a snooze. So I thought, yeah, Bobby's going to probably leave, and then Heitman's going to leave. Heitman won't battle. He'll let the horse go, but then he'll retake because he doesn't want to sit behind a stopper like Cold Blue. But he did. Heitman sat behind him. But Cold Blue lasted. She lasted until the stretch, until the middle of the stretch before she caved in and ran fourth. Heitman won the race. Came in 1-7-9-4 as they put up 1-7-9-4. But as my eyes watched the race, it was a tight photo for second. Oosteen on the 9 followed the 1 right up the... 1 took the lead, got loose, and then Oosteen followed him up on the inside. And I said, okay, came back 1-9. I had a nice exacta going. I was paying $28. The 1-7 was only paying $15. But I bet a 1-9 because I figured Heitman, the 7's going to be getting, he's going to get away way back. And Oosteen's going to get a nice trip. He's got speed. He's going to follow that 1 right out of there with speed. And he's going to get the trips. Might come back 1-9 here. And that's the way it looked like it came back when they hit the wire. Now the 7 was flying on the outside from dead last. The right move with Sammy the Witch Pidge Winger. But as they hit the wire, I said, 9 held on. Because I call them. I know I can call them. Seen 20,000, 50,000, 100,000 races at Maywood. But sure enough, they put the 7 up second. What? I watched the slow-mo after the race, you know, the slow-mo replay that they show right after the horses, the race ends. They showed that the horse is hitting the wire. I go, no, inside horse held on there. But they put the 7 up. Surprised the shit out of me. So, well, maybe I'm wrong. Cost me a nice try and a nice exacta. So I waited for the photo to be, you know, how they show the photo. They always show the photos after the replay. After it's official, after they show the replay, then they show the rundown, and then the photo goes up. I want to see that photo. But they never put it up. No, they never put the photo up in their last race. So I woke up Saturday morning, and I go, I got to watch the replay on my channel here. Because I know I could stop action that replay right on the wire. I could hit the button, I could hit the clicker here in the mouse, and I could stop it right on the wire. And I want to see what it looks like to me. And I stopped it right on the wire. Then I stopped it 1 foot past the wire. And I'm going, oh, come on. There ain't no way this 9 ain't second. Why didn't they put the photo up? At least show us. I know if they put it up, it's going to show the 7 second. They never put up a photo that doesn't show who they put up second. But why didn't they show the photo Friday night? And then I'm looking at this replay and stopping it right on the wire. And I'm going, no way. There's no shot when they hit that wire that 9 wasn't ahead of this horse by a long nose. Now, step after the wire might have been a different story. It was real close to step after, but remember, the 7 was flying. So he should have passed them after the wire. But when they hit that wire, so I snapped it. I snapped the thing with my phone here. I snapped it up with the old iPhone. Zoomed in on it, and I snapped the picture right on the wire that I stopped action on the replay. And it's one after the wire. And then I posted it on the Ultimate Harness Racing discussion forum. And I asked for opinions from people, but I didn't get no opinions from nobody. Because I said the 9 was second. Only the great one came on. And George said, well, the second photo, which was the one after the wire, looks like the 7 had it. Well, I'm not going to dispute that, George. Because after the wire, which doesn't count, the 7 might have passed him because he was flying. But the photo above that, the other one I posted, tell me that the 9 wasn't second. Go draw a line on your screen. Why didn't the judges put the photo up? That's what pisses me off. I want to know that I was wrong. No, I'll tell you why. Because I've been in the business in Chicago since 1975. And I'm going to tell you guys that don't know nothing, that don't know what goes on. Let me tell you about these stewards in Chicago that's been this way for the last 40 years. When that last race ends at Maywood Park, or Sportsman's, or Belmore, or whatever track, they want to get the hell out of there. Unless there's a real blatant inquiry where they got to stick around, they want to get the hell out of there as fast as they can. And you know what they used to do back in the 90s and 80s? They would actually tell them, don't post the prices yet. They make it official. But don't post the prices yet. Give us a chance to leave the booth up there, get down the elevator to the escalators, and get the hell out of the door so I can beat the traffic out of the track. Because we don't want to sit in that massive traffic when they had crowds back then. We don't want to sit in that traffic. So don't put the prices up. And then nobody will leave. Okay? Except the ones that lost. They know they lost. And we can get the hell out of here. And that's what they used to do. Ask anybody. Ask anybody that knows anything. Ask any horseman that knows anything. That's what the stewards used to do. They want to get the hell out of there because it's already going on midnight almost. 11:30, quarter to 12 midnight. They want to get the hell out of there. And they want to beat that traffic. So maybe that's what they did Friday night. I just put the 7 up. He looked like he was second. And besides that, Joe Mazzone was calling the 7 like a madman. Like a madman. Like he was flying. He was going to fly by the whole field. So he must have been second. Just put him up. I don't even see no photo. Let's get the hell out of here. It's 12 o'clock. I don't know what went on. Go on the forum. You look at the photo, the top photo. You tell me if the 9 wasn't second. Maybe they'll put the photo up Thursday night, coming up this next Thursday. Maybe they'll put the photo up for the last race at Maywood. Maybe they'll put it up. They'll snap a few, you know, they'll go back and say, hey, where's those photos from the last race? Did we take any? Okay, put the one up that shows that the horse, put the one up, you know, because they don't know where the wire's at. We draw our own line. You know, on the photos, we draw our own line. The photo comes back, it takes several snaps, it takes multiple snaps as the horses hit the wire and go past the wire. So we'll find the one that we like. And then we'll draw the line there, and it'll show the 7 being second. So if it's the one after the wire, a foot after the wire, yeah, we'll use that one. Draw the line down there and then put it up there because Nance is complaining we didn't put the photo up. We got to prove Nance to be wrong. So put that one up. Maybe they'll do that Thursday since they didn't put the photo up Friday night after the races were over. Yeah, I'll tell it like it is. I don't care who likes it. Do the right thing. You want to run a racetrack, you want to be a steward, you want to get paid $200,000 a year, then put the photo up after the race, like you're supposed to do. Why didn't they put it up Friday? They do it all the other times. So anyway, That's Friday night. Let's go to Saturday. Which was last night, right? With all that screaming and yanking and raining, I gotta have a drink. Alright. Let's see what we find Friday night, Saturday night. Well, I'll tell you what we find. We find 4 top-rated winners. We find 3 second-rated winners. We find 3 third-rated winners. And 1 fourth-rated winner. So out of the 12 races, 7 winners came out of my top 2. Out of the 12 races, 10 winners came out of my top 3 horses. Saturday night. Yeah, they did. That's right. Oh, and before I get into the results, let me mention this too. Balmoral Park, with their short fields and entries and ratty races, and supposedly to everybody else out there, the drivers and trainers in Chicago are all third-rated guys. They don't compare to those hot shots on the East Coast. Well, guess what? Balmoral outhandled Yonkers. Yeah. The Levy series last night at Yonkers. Where Tietrich went over to drive and Gingrich was there. And who else? And Foiled again. All the big horses racing and the big drivers and the leading trainers like Tracy Brainerd and Julie Miller and Ron Burke and all those guys. Bill Laurel and their rats outhandled Yonkers by $142,000. Same amount of races, 12 races. Bill Laurel handled just under $1 million. Yonkers handled 700 and something thousand. Boy, I'll tell you what. Thank God for those blood slots, huh? Thank God for that welfare money for those people out there, those drivers, trainers, owners, and all those people benefiting by those blood slot tracks. Because otherwise they'd be busted just like Chicago guys are and everybody else that's racing for nothing. They'd be busted too, driving old pickup trucks and going to Walmart to shop for their clothes. Not buying Nikes. That's right, tell it like it is. Thank God, go to church every Sunday and go there and thank God that you guys got blood slots so that you can live high on the hog, you know, and everything. But I tell you what, nobody cares because the handle at Yonkers and all those other tracks, Pocono Downs a joke. Handle at all those tracks a joke. Nobody cares about you guys except a handful of diehard harness fans like me. Who cares? The public doesn't care, but you guys care because you don't care if you race in front of 50 people. As long as I got that purse money coming in and I can go buy myself a new house, a new truck and clothes and walk around with thousands in my pocket, that's all that matters. Give me those blood slot money. Yeah, that's the way it turned out for harness racing. It's a shame. Killed it. Killed it. And the very business, check this out. The very business that's destroyed harness racing, the casino industry, you got horsemen. Now, this is what I'm told, okay? This is what I was told last week, or early last week sometime. Guy told me, because I don't do Facebook. I can't stand social media. I hate it. I don't do it. I don't read it. Don't know nothing about it. But a guy told me that because he's on Facebook and he does the Facebook shit. He told me that horsemen in Ohio. And by the way, oh, their purses are so great. They got a casino. Really? We were racing for more money than they're racing for back in the 80s. We race for more money than they are now. But they think they got good handle. They got good purses, I mean. You know, 6,000. Some of them are 2,900 still. 29. They have 1 or 2 days where purses are 6, 7, 8,000. Maybe the invite's going for 10 or 12 or whatever the hell it's going for. We race for way more than that back in the 80s. But they're satisfied because they were going for 2,000. But anyway, I'm told that you got horsemen, drivers and horsemen on Facebook. And they're posting vouchers, bragging about what they won in the casino. So after the races are over, they got nothing to do, I guess, and they want to go drink. Because, you know, most horsemen, they like to drink. You know?
They go up to the casino. There's nothing to do. Nothing to do in Ohio. Everything's shut down. We'll go up to the casino and we'll drink, get free drinks, and we'll play machines and maybe some table game, but we'll pump those machines. And then when we win, we'll post our vouchers on Facebook and show everybody, hey, look what I won in the casino. I won 1,000, I won 2, I won 4, I won 500. Look at this. Really? Why don't you, well, maybe they do, but why don't you pour money into the handle? You're going up there and supporting the casino. Dude, I want to know how many of the casino employees go to the races and lose their paychecks and their money on betting on the horses. Do they support the horse racing industry, those casino workers? I doubt it. But those horsemen run up to that grandstand and that casino and they play. And then they brag about what they're winning. And let me tell you something. I'll tell you what. You want to brag about what you're winning? How about doing this? At the end of the year, get your printout from the casino. Your won-loss statement. Now, if you're playing on a player's card, they have it. Now, if you don't play on a player's card, I guess they don't. But for all you braggers out there, and this goes for anybody that goes to casinos, and they want to show people when they win, but they never show you the losers. They only show you the winners. Okay? Just like with horse racing ticket. They'll show you the winners, but they'll never show you the losers. Get your readout at the end of the year from the casino, and I'll bet anything that you're in the red when it's all said and done, because nobody beats the casino and nobody beats slot machines. You might win. You might win here and there. In the end, you're going to be in the red, pal. You'll be in the red. That's right. Same goes for me. I go to the Rampart with the wife and play, and I hit Royals for 1,000, this, that, a couple thousand, 500 here. At the end of the year, I'm a loser. It's entertainment, that's all it is. You're never going to be ahead playing slots unless you get lucky and win Mega Bucks or Wheel of Fortune or some crap like that. And who wins that? One out of every 2 million people? 3 million? But they're up there, the horsemen, they're up there, they're going up there to the casino, and they're spending their driver's checks and their purse checks, and they're losing it to the casino. They're getting it back somehow. They're getting that purse money back somehow. Yeah. And that probably goes on at all the other racinos too. Horsemen run up there, drink and play machines, and then go on Facebook and post what they want. Nonsense. Social media. Yeah. Anyway, that's what happened. Don't moral outhandle the Yonkers and all the hot shots out there. Just want to bring that up, since everybody always cutting down Chicago racing and all that. Yeah, it's bad. It's bad. It's garbage. Horses and that. Why do they outhandle everybody else except the Meadowlands? Oh, and by the way, the Meadowlands handle's dropping too. So I'm sure Gorel's real happy about that. They only handled 2,600,000 on Saturday night. They were handling up in the threes last year. And Friday night, 1,900,000. Where they were handling up near the threes on Friday last year. So handle's dropping at the Meadowlands too. How do you like that, Jeffy? More to complain about, right? You guys don't have enough to complain about that you're losing millions of dollars and you should have never bought the Meadowlands because you're worried if you're going to get slot machines or not. Right? And now you're mad because they took away that rule that you proposed because, you know, you're the dictator, Jeff. You know, and you got to rule the harness racing industry and you can't race at my track and that track and my track at Vernon and my Tioga track and my Meadowlands racetrack. You can't race. You're no good. Get out of here. And I'm going to put other rules in effect. Because I'm the dictator now. I own 3 racetracks. I'm a millionaire. I'll run everybody's life for them. Yeah, well, sorry about your luck, Jeff. Handle's dropping. Live with it. See how... Well, maybe you'll get slot machines. And then the law will recover. You can walk around happy at your age. I wouldn't worry about nothing at your age. To tell you the truth, Jeffy. Wouldn't worry about nothing at your age. You should be out spending those millions of dollars you got running around the world with your wife and enjoying everything. And forget about that Meadowlands and racing. Whatever happens, happens. You can't take it with you. So you lose some money. You're not going to go broke, busted, living on the street like some people. Don't know where your next meal's coming from. Go spend the money you got at your age because tomorrow the good Lord might take it all away. Like the song says. Now remember, Jeffy, it's a man's world,
But it wouldn't be nothing, nothing, without a woman or a girl. So go, take your wife around the world with all those millions, and be with your woman. That's what's the most important thing. Not stupid money. Anyway, let's move on to the results. Yeah, let's move on to the results for race number one. Of course, I had him rated 517.264. Now the five horse, Beachside Bungalow, destroyed these horses last week in 53-3 last quarter, 28-4. He's 2-5. Supposed to be 2-5. The 1-7 figured behind him. This horse could not even be second last night, Beachside Bungalow. Couldn't be second. Made his move. He even went by Bobby in the stretch. And then all of a sudden he just came up a rat. And Bobby came back on him with the 7 and beat him. Not only beat him, the 5 runs third. He can't even be second at 2-5 after destroying this bunch last week. So comes back 715, pays good. Box up my top three, $124 try. Don't key off that 2-5 shot, because they'll let you down every time. Box them up, $124 try for 12 bucks, $85 extra for 12 bucks, and laugh at everybody that the 2-5 ran third. And the super paid $229 with the two horse who I had ran fourth. Simple as pie, right? But it's a joke. It's a total joke how these horses are such rats. Oh, yeah, Tony Aladna, that's right, Beachside Bungalow. He must have not have flew in from New York or wherever the hell he's at. He must not have flew in to train the horse last week. So he came up a rat. Is that the excuse? Come on, he's never there anyway. Came up a rat at 2-5. Second race, second rated winner. Top rated ran second. Nice $28 exact, but box my top two. My fourth rated horse ran third. Tri paid $86. And the super came back $321. My sixth horse, who I had rated lower down, ran fourth. So there you go. Top two rated horses ran 1-2. The fourth horse ran third. And there's your Guinness. Gonna pound it on that exact, the $28. $20 exact, the box, $280. Race number three, third rated winner. Second rated ran second. Fourth rated ran third. Top rated ran fourth. Chalk payouts, $14 exact, the $39 try, $49 super, nothing to write home about. Third rated horse on top. Won the race. Cam Weiser. Yeah, he came up third rated. Yeah, everybody knows he's going off chalk, but he came up third rated tonight. But he got the job done again. Doesn't matter. So that's how that race went. And then we move on to the old proverbial Fort Silky races. Same horses every week with the other, with the old five horse field. And I had rated 5-4-3-1-2. They came in 3-5-1. I didn't write down what they paid, didn't bet the race. Just started pick fives. I don't bet these races. I told you that last week. I'm not betting these kind of races. They can keep. And do you know what? Only 38,000 was handled in that race. Of course, they didn't have a try in there. Only exact is in win, place, and choke. And pick five. But only 38K was bet in that race. Because the public doesn't like this shit either. But Fort Silky won again. How are you going to beat a horse like that when he goes to the half in 57-1? That's a training model for these horses. Nobody will race the horse. Well, we know Ama Bonacera's not racing nobody because he's going to close from dead last every week. But you know what? Best Man Hanover has some speed. Canaris has some speed. First Class All the Way has speed. Why can't they challenge the horse? You know, race him a little the first quarter, the half. Sting him a little bit if you're going to try to beat him. No, they just let Silky go to the lead and let him walk to the half. Line up and let him walk to the half. And then we'll try to race him down the lane. And I'll see, maybe he'll come up a rat and we'll beat him. 57-1 to the half. You ain't beating a horse like this. And I'm a Bonacera. That horse is way back. And then he kicks into the stretch, of course, and comes flying. But it's too late. He can't catch him. He only can get second. With these best horses on the ground, garbage race. For betters. Excuse me. Race number 5. Top-rated winner. Third-rated ran second. Second-rated ran third. Had him rated 5.26, 8.13. Came in 5.62. Chalk payouts, $10 exact, $22 try. Can't make no money. Can't make no money on that. Had the 5 top-rated. I think he paid 5.40 or something. He beat the 6, who everybody was pounding on. But the DNRS number said that the 5 was better than the 6, and he was. 100 to win would have been nice, huh? And then team on top with the 2 and the 6, $10 tries. That's the only way you can make money with those payouts. Okay, then we move on to race number 6, where we had a second-rated winner. AJ gets the money again. AJ got the money. You know AJ, Al Johnson? That's who this horse was named after. Former owner Al Johnson. I don't know if he's still in the business. Al Johnson. He had a lot of horses. AJ gets the money. Al Johnson gets the cash. That's who used to own this horse. Bred by Robert Rehnquist. Right. And had him rated 2.61845. Came in 6.841. Second rated horse on top, 5 deep. Top 2 rated on top, 5 deep. $59 exacta, nice. $369 try, nice. $744 super, even nicer. Second rated horse on top. There you go. Now they bet Warren down, my top rated. They blasted on him. He went to the lead. Looked like he was going to win, but then he stopped. Guess he couldn't handle a class hike from 4 to 6. Guess he's just a rat 4 claimer. But down there he did show getting beat a nose in a 7 claimer to Meadowbrook Sam down there in the line. He did show second to Flying Rocket in a 6 claimer. He showed a third against AJ Gets the Money. And then he had 2 nice, powerful wins in a row. 53-2 last time. Don't care if he beat 4 claimers or not. Bet on him, old class horse, he beat. And then he wired him at Maywood out of the 8 hole. But he was no good last night. He came up a rat at the 16th hole. He stopped. Chalk off the board, Bobby wins. Second rated on top, 5 deep. Get the money. Oh, a 7th race comes up. Yeah, top rated winner. No surprise. Chalk. Red Hot Art. But there was nonsense in the race. I had him rated 159.826. Came in 1.265. Top rated horse on top, 5 deep. And a nice payout. $53 exacta. $288 try. And a $700 super. Top rated on top, 5 deep. Yeah, with the chalk. And there was nonsense in the race because the 9 horse, who I had rated 3rd, he was on the lead, but then he decided to jump around the last turn. He jumped and he took the 8 horse out of the race, who I had rated 4th. So those 2 were out. Those 2 numbers, DNR's number, were out. Bombed out of the race. But the other numbers came in, and the 2 horse went off 30-1 and made it all pay because he ran 2nd. And then the 6 horse, he was 3rd, and he was 15-1 long morning line long shot. So he made it all pay, even though the chalk won it. Top rated horse on top, 5 deep. Get the cash. All right. And then race number 8, top rated winner. No surprise there, Jericho. No surprise at all in the exact, the ice cold, 2-1, 7.40. I had the 4 horse rated 4th, he ran 3rd. I had the 7 horse rated 3rd, he ran 4th. So there you go. Top rated on top with the other 3 numbers right underneath them. $45 try and a $68 super. Take what they give you that race. Now we move on to race number 9. Oh, I didn't have nothing in here. Oh yeah, the filly and mare 4 claiming rats, who pulls as non-winners of 10,000 last 5. This Riley's daughter, Riley's Lily, won last week off the class drop in 53. Been racing against top horse mares on the grounds. beats them half the time, sometimes runs second to them. Took a class drop last week and won for fun. Back up there were, you know, against the little better fillies, which she competed against many times and beat many times. Total rat last night, right? It's filly. Total rat! Couldn't pace in 53 again last night. Total rat. Came up a rat. Yeah. Armis Lily. Couldn't win back either. That four claimer who won last week against these. That's why they're all fours. Like I told you, they're all fours. Scarlet and Silk won the race. Didn't have her rated nowhere. This is her second start. Yeah, she had the five hole last week. He just ducked her. Sat her on the wood. Got away seventh. Got shuffled to eighth. Never pulled her. Just sat there. Sucked along, as they say. Suck along. And then finished fifth by length and by a length and three quarters. Not, I mean, shoot. The line doesn't show that she's, like, exploded down the lane. She come a nice last quarter, granted. She only got beat a length and three quarters. But she never made a move, never used a rat. But she come flying last night on the outside, and she did win it. She did win it. She hadn't raced since December of last year, off the qualifier. Poor, poor qualifier, by the way. Fifth by nine. And then she hadn't raced since last December, where she won two races in December. And now winners of 8,000 last five, this class. So I guess she was ready. She was ready. She wasn't ready for me last night, though. But she'll probably come up top rated next week off last night's ever. But what I know, I want to ask you something. I noticed something. I want to know how a so-called handicappers, guys that do handicapping for newspapers, websites, publications, different things like that. They're considered handicappers. They're hired, and they give the public their selections. I want to know how a handicapper that gives the public their selections, which the public is thinking in their mind, okay, this is what the guy likes. This is what he truly likes, and what he truly must feel is going to win these races, okay? And he gives me his best horses. Okay, that's what the public thinks. Just like when the people buy my numbers. This is what Dan's numbers are. This is what he rates. And this is what Dan's going to bet too. Which I do. I don't go and give out my numbers and then go play a horse that I got rated next to last in my tickets. I don't do that. That would make me look bad, wouldn't it? If I give my numbers out and then I go and I tell people, oh, I had that pick four. How? You had the seven horse rated next to last. How did you wind up using the seven in every ticket that you had? Oh, am I going to give them a lie? Am I going to lie to them and say, well, I was watching the action on the board. I was watching the action, and they were betting him a little bit. He was like 6-1. And I figured I better stick him in every ticket. Even though my handicapping had him picked next to last. Come on, that's no excuse. You handicap the races, you know what you see on the program from the week before, and that's what you're handicapping off of, right? So that's what you're, if you're a public handicapper and you're putting your selections out there, that's what you tell people that who you think could win, based on that. But then you go and you bet tickets, pick four tickets, and you use a horse that you had picked next to last. And then you go on Twitter and you brag and put up your tickets about what you won. Three different combinations. You kid them all with the seven horse in them that you had picked next to last. I don't get that, okay? Nothing personal against anybody. Nothing personal. Okay, let's get that straight right here now. I'm not knocking anybody. I'm talking handicapping. I'm talking harness racing here. Nothing personal. It's not a personal attack here. It's an attack on someone picking a horse for the public, next to last, and then using that horse in every ticket in your pick four. But you didn't like him when you handicapped the race. Okay, that's all I could say about that. That'd be like me doing, that'd be like me putting my numbers out and then betting the horse I got picked next to last and then bragging about that I won. I'd have guys steaming at me. But I'm not going to do that. Because you know what? This is the thing that people don't know, okay? I don't care if you're all the handicappers in newspapers or wherever you're at, if you're a so-called professional handicapper, that you're hired by newspapers, Sun-Times, Tribune, Illinois Harness Horsemen's Association, Balmoral Park, DRF, Racing Forum, Meadowlands, whoever you're hired by to put your selections up. If a guy like that who is putting out public selection, if he likes a horse that he's been watching, and he doesn't want to hurt the odds on the horse, do you think he's going to actually pick him to win? Or to be second? He likes this horse. Let's knock the odds down. No! Oh, I like this horse, and I want to use him, so let me pick him down low. Let me pick him down low, and then that way my odds won't be hurt. Yeah. Don't think that doesn't happen since the cows came home with handicappers. That's why every one of them, you look and see mostly all their selections are morning line, second favorite, third favorite chalks as their top three selections. That's right. Race number 10. Second rated winner. Halfway decent payouts and the try, nothing on the Exacta. Second rated winner on top five deep again. Exacta only paid $11. But the try paid $96. Halfway decent. The super paid $339. Cam Weiser. I had him rated second. Sorry about that. They pounded him down and he won like a champ. Class horse. Yep. The other class horse ran second. I had him rated down a little lower. Heitman's horse. Some stars somewhere. 3-year-old last year raced against McWicked and Super Sweet Rockin' them. Yeah, he shook loose and got second too. So that's the way that goes. Second rated winner on top five deep. And race number 11. I had the fourth rated winner in there. Real or Magic. Didn't write the payoffs down. Didn't have the three. He snuck in there for third. So that's the way that race went. No cash there. Fourth rated winner. And then in the last race, had the Exacta Ice Cold. Had him rated 176.352. The five was scratched. Came in 172. No surprise there. 1.7. Had the three rated fourth. That's where he rated. Now there was a trainer change from Gregory to Roberts, and then a driver change to Oosteen. Some might have said, and even I did. Well, I looked at the payoffs on the 1.7. I'm going, damn. $10 Exacta that thing's paying, that's not going to make me no money, you know, unless you pound on huge gimmicks and anything can happen. So let me hope that this fourth rated horse with Oosteen and the trainer change, let me hope that he gets at least second. So I'll play big tickets with the three on top and for second with the 1 and 7. Maybe Ronnie Roberts can pull one of those Ronnie Roberts jobs and get this horse there. Because he's been racing decent at times, he's on and off horse, but he throws good miles. Maybe Ronnie can improve off of Gregory. And Oosteen up. Well, he left. He got away in the two-hole. Get that perfect trip behind the one horse, the winner. Then in the stretch, he was a pig. The three was a pig. Stopped off the board. So it's back to the drawing board for Ronnie Roberts. Off the trainer change. And the driver change. Stunk it up. I had him rated fourth, and he didn't even get fourth. Stunk it up. So the trainer change and the driver change didn't help. Back to the drawing board. So that's how Saturday ended. Good numbers, good gimmicks, whatever. So three nights of a lot of DNRS winners. No, wouldn't you say? And a lot of DNRS gimmicks, whatever. All right. So tonight, Balmoral, tonight, like I mentioned earlier, 7-horse field, first race, 7-horse field in the second race, 8-horse field in the third race, 10-horse field of rats in the rat trotters in the fourth race, so beware about that. Half of them will be jumping, breaking, you don't know what's going to happen. So take your chances on that race. And then the fifth race, another 8-horse field, the four claimers. 8-horse field again. Oh, they let Justice Jet back in. Justice Jet had a couple weeks off, so he's ready to roll again. Yeah, he's in against these pigs again.
But then again, he could get beat. He might get beat tonight. Yeah, he's been off a couple weeks. Who knows? Then again, he might not. Celebrity Hercules, Usteen, he might beat him. Yeah, that's about the only horse I could see in here that might beat him. Fox Valley Vito, that inconsistent thing, always around the money, second, win, third. Can't rely on him, though. Never know about him. Sometimes he throws in a break, too. But Celebrity Hercules and Usteen, whole class horse right there. Maybe he'll beat Justice Jet. But then again, nobody might beat him again. Justice Jet might stay undefeated this year. And then in the seventh race, we got an 8-horse field. Started the pick four. Yep. Another wonderful race. 9 winners of 3. Same horses back in against each other. And then we got race number 8. 9-horse field. Philly and Merritt, 9 winners of 2 rats. Yep. Another wonderful race there. And then race number 9. We got the old Tater Twister, Trotters. Let's see here. Yeah, Warren's got one in. Well, Todd owns them too, I see here. Yep. Oh, we got a text here I got to read, guys. Excuse me for a minute. Okay. So anyway, yeah, we'll see how if Todd tries with this trotter, like he didn't try with the other one last week. And then in the 10th race, we got a field of 10. So full field in the last race. Hey, does Todd got that other horse in tonight? I didn't know. I think he did. I thought I saw him in. Where's that other trot race at? Yeah. Oh yeah, there he is. Yeah. Well, look what happened in the second race tonight. Bam's Alexis. What's Todd gonna do tonight? Went off at $1.90 to one last week. And he, like I said, he never pulled him, never gave him a shot. Then he was full of trot coming to the wire. What's going to happen tonight? Is he going to get bet down again big? Is he going to try? What's he going to do? Roll him tonight maybe? Or maybe stiff him? I don't want to say stiff. I don't want to use that word stiff. Maybe not make it look like the horse ain't ready again. Maybe get a better price next week and prove that, like, oh, you see, he wasn't really that good last week. See, they're wrong. They all thought that he was good last week, but they weren't, you know, and I went. So I'll just make him look like he was like last week, you know, so it doesn't make me look bad like I didn't pull him last week whatever. Anyway, Ben's Alexis is in tonight. We'll see how he does. Yeah. The guy that got burned out of the pick five last week, maybe he could single him this week in the start of the pick five and get his money back since Todd didn't try last week. Well, that's tonight's card. All right. So what else we got to go before I go? Huh? 2:10 here. 3 more hours yet before Balmoral. All right. The contest on Saturday. Oh, no. Friday night's contest. The Saratoga contest for the HorseTourneys.com Meadowlands team. Our buddy, Big Al Lorenz, King of Crete, just got snapped out of the win. Finished second by $1 and change. Sorry for that, Al. You gave it a big shot. I was hoping you'd get the cash, Al. Our buddy from Chi-Town, Big Al Lorenz. Longtime Chicago man. Honest guy. But he got snapped by $1 and change again. He had the winner in the last race. Unfortunately, he didn't pay enough to put him into the lead by $1. By $2. All he needed was $2 more. And he wins. $2. But the horse didn't play enough to win in place to surpass the guy in front of him. The guy had him by $9, I think, going into the last leg. But Big Al's horse didn't pay enough. So, sorry about that, Al. I noticed a lot of names in there. Soudel was in there. He was in the competition. He was in the run, too, but he came up short. Old Steve came up short. Maybe if Steve would be a little nicer person to people in life and wouldn't go on forums and say stuff about people and talk all the garbage and crime syndicates and Bobby Smolens and everybody else, maybe his luck would be a little bit better. You know, be a little better person, you know, and maybe you snap that first place prize. But whatever, Steve. Yeah, nothing, nothing. You and I are cool, Steve. Don't worry about it. You and I are cool. But anyway, that's what the contest happened. I had 3 or 4 winners, but I didn't do any good. I finished 100 in some place. I don't know. I bet numbers. I didn't even handicap. I looked at the horses. Yeah, I like that guy and this guy. I ain't handicapping this shit. I'm not going to win it anyway. Besides that, forget it. But I did notice that our man Rick Yarder from Albany, you know, the original Piglin, he was in the contest, sitting up there like 25th, he was in the hunt. Yeah, Rick Yarder, he's a Saratoga guy. He knows that track, that's it. But the thing I'm wondering is this. Why would he even get in it? If he wins it and goes to the Meadowlands, and say he won the 50 grand at the Meadowlands, Costello's going to get the money anyway. The money's going to go to Bob Costello. Got the judgment against him for $578,000. He's going to tap right into that 50 G's if he won it. Man. Anyway, that's it. And then, PA Harness Week kicks off this weekend. I hope you guys watch PA Harness Week. It's always a fun show to watch with Steve Ross. He's got the tan going on all the time, you know, and always trying to be funny and stuff. And you got Heather Vitale there, the girl on the run, the girl on the move. She's always going, moving. Yeah, oh, the hell, Heather. Yeah, Heather. Yeah, she's always fun to watch. She's got those facial expressions going on. Every time Steve says something and she's not talking, she... Yeah, the gal's funny. Yeah, she tries to put on the show. Got to give her credit. Oh, Heather Vitale. Yeah. Oh, Heather, if you ever watch my videos, say hi to Tony Morgan for me out there in Delaware, will you? Say hi. Tell Dan Nance said hello. And tell Dan Nance said thanks for all those winners that he put across for me. And then all the, you know, because I gave him those nice tips I always gave him. Ask him if he remembers that, Heather. Yeah. Ask old Tony. Yeah. Always took care of Tony. Yeah, with the tips. Yeah, he gave me a couple... No try drives, but got to live with them, you know, Kissing Joes and a couple other horses, you know. But most of all, when Tony figured out Dan can win this race, yeah, he's got this baby ready. I'm going to go up and I'm going to call offshore and I'm going to make a bet on him, you know, and I'm going to bet on myself whether I send someone to the windows, you know. My Greek friend, what was his name, Popopoulos or Popopoulos or whatever the heck the owner was, I'll send him up the window and tell him to bet because I'm driving an Nance horse, you know, or I'll call offshore, whatever he did. Say hi to Tony for me, Heather. Tell him I hope he gets to that 15,000 range real fast. So anyway, that's it. Oh, Barn to Wire real quick? Come on, I got to hang up here. Let's go to Barn to Wire. There's nothing going on, okay? There's nothing going on at Barn to Wire. But let's see if there's anything that is worth addressing here. Because there's really nothing on there anymore. Woodbine, Meadowlands, Burton, no. Really nothing. They're talking about wrestling. Illinois lawmakers, there's nothing. No, there's nothing to address, nothing going on. You know, I'm glad there's no Nance stuff on there because Nance is blocked and that's good. So that's it, you know. They rag on Burton here. I see that they're always pounding on Burton for some reason and they're complaining because topics get put taken down. I noticed that, but who cares about none of that nonsense? But it's, oh, and they, you know, they, I don't know what, they're not doing anything on here. There's really nothing going on. So it's a dead game, laddies. It's a dead game. It's a dead form, laddies. So anyway, that'll probably do it here for this week's version of the DNRS recap and whatever else I talked about. And I'm going to get going now and get ready for Balmoral tonight and see what's going on with that carryover in the last race at the Hell Expo. I might throw a ticket in on that and maybe play the 20-cent pick four out there, you know. Because, you know, it's West Coast and the races go, you know, till 8:39 here? I don't know. But they're going. They're going after Balmoral shuts down. You still got four or five races for Cal. Yeah. Get a little Cal Expo on a Sunday night before Revenge comes on. The old Revenge at 10 o'clock. But that show ain't no good anymore either. There's no good shows on. Maybe the Blacklist is all right. No good shows on anymore, TV. And then you got to watch commercials every 2 seconds. Every 2 seconds a commercial now. Makes it depressing to watch TV. So anyway, guys, it was good talking to you. I hope you guys make some money tonight in the races and get ready for next week, Thursday to Sunday. And I'll see you next time around on another DNRS recap show. So until then, take care, everybody. Good racing.